2:25. We are here with the chair today. Phil's Folk is what we're calling it today. That is, unless Jason and or Liz have got a better idea. And the good afternoon to you both. Lovely to have you. Say good afternoon.
Afternoon.
Good afternoon. Afternoon.
Because we had that many suggestions, some of which, look, I typed nicely. The rest are scrawled on by hand. Various suggestions for this feature, including the Phantom Flen Flingers Perch, Sydney, which I quite like the idea of calling it Sydney, Cherry McChairface, but today I went with the straightforward idea of calling it Phil's Folk, because there are two of you, and I couldn't think what else to call it, really. That is, Liz, unless you've got a better idea, would you like to call it something else?
I quite like the last suggestion.
You like Cherry McChairface, did you? Jason, you've brought your own chair, which is fantastic of you. How are you keeping?
Lovely
to see you both. You're both looking bright-eyed and bushy-tailed, I have to say. And the story is one, actually, your story is one that people will be vaguely familiar with, I think. And we'll talk about some of it, not least of all because, Jason, you got quite a lot of TV coverage because you had a search for a new digital voice, didn't you?
Indeed.
And how did that go? Was that good?
It went very well indeed.
And am I right in thinking, Liz, that was the first time there'd been a search for a digital voice to be used in Jason's situation?
Jason took part in a research project in Edinburgh.
That was it, yeah.
Yeah. And basically, 80% of people with motor neurone disease have communication difficulties or lose the ability to speak altogether.
Yeah.
And this clinic in Edinburgh were trialling a research project to use donor voices to create a synthesised computer voice with unique accents for people with motor neurone disease or other speech problems.
Okay, so Jason, the voice we've got today, this is your real voice that we've got today. If you had the vocaliser here, did you call it a vocaliser?
Computerized version of my own voice.
Okay, and what does it sound like? Does it sound anything like you?
Yeah.
Does
very,
it?
Very much so, yeah.
Oh, wow, what about that? How long have you known each other then, Liz? When did you guys first meet?
We met in 2009.
So, it's 2018, okay, comparatively recently-ish, I suppose. And so you never knew each other before, you didn't go to school together, did you grow up in the same towns? Where did you grow up, Jason?
I was Scarborough.
Scarborough, Liz?
I grew up in Hull and then East Yorkshire.
So how did you meet then?
We actually met via Facebook.
Oh, did you?
Yeah, absolutely.
Well, and this wasn't kind of Lonely Hearts or anything. This was friends of friends and you were friends of friends?
Something like that, and we got chatting and then we eventually, I think Jason asked me to meet up with him and it kind of went from there, really.
Yeah, motorbikes. I know we're an important part and still are an important part of your life. So if you were from Scarborough, Jason, you are from Scarborough, did you ever get a chance to do... I mean, there's big motorbike meetings happen there regularly. Were you ever part of those?
No.
Not that you're not that keen?
No, I got into bikes a bit later in life.
Oh, did you?
Yeah.
Well, is that because, like, Mum and Dad wouldn't let you have a bike or it's just...
No, more into cars.
More into cars, yeah. I had a brief flirtation with... motorbikes, but then that was followed by a slightly longer flirtation with golf, the game of golf. And I like a motorbike, but you can't get a set of golf clubs on the back of them, can you? I mean, no, unless that's just me.
You can get a tent on the back of one.
Can you?
Yeah,
and,
absolutely.
And when you went off, you guys went off and got married at the pub, Tan Hill, there, and you had a sheep as a ring bearer. Well, you didn't take the sheep on the back of the bike as well, did you?
No, the sheep was already there, but they very kindly bathed the sheep the night before, so she was nice and white and fluffy.
And slightly less smelly than she might have been otherwise.
Absolutely. We were a bit worried about the smelliness.
How often do you get back to Tan Hill? I mean, because is it the highest pub in England?
It's the highest pub in England. It's about 1,723 feet above sea level. Yeah, and it's on a very lonely moorside, and it's always extremely windy and cold.
Always,
even in
every time of year. Yeah, absolutely. So heaven only knows what it's like there this afternoon. It's probably very, very bleak there this afternoon.
I think it's covered in snow at the moment. I've seen some pictures, and I think it's covered in snow. Yeah.
Why did you choose Tan Hill, Jason?
Went to the Tales on one of our first on weekends away.
Oh, right, okay.
And went there and it seemed a little bit different.
Yeah.
And, we wanted to sort of step away from the norm. So, that it was.
And is that something that kind of typifies your relationship, if I can ask you that, Liz? You know, there's this kind of trying to do it a little bit differently, step away from the norm. Does that kind of sum you guys up a little bit?
Yeah, I think so. We've never been really a typical couple, and we've always liked doing things a bit different. And, you know, Tan, he'll have a big bike meeting up there, and we'd been up on the bike and we'd really enjoyed ourselves and had a fab time, so we just decided to go for it. It was all a last minute thing, really.
Oh, brilliant. Hey, look, we've got traffic and travel news, and when that arrives, we'll hear the latest from Greg, and we want to play some of your choices of music this afternoon, as well as chatting to the both of you. We can't obviously have this conversation without talking, Jason, about your motor neuron disease. When you guys first met, you're in a wheelchair now, but you were very, very able-bodied then.
Yeah, I was, yeah.
So no clue at all, even though this was only 9 years ago, my maths is rubbish, there or thereabouts, 9, 10 years ago.
No,
indication at all.
No, at all.
Gosh. I mean, you will have learnt so much, I know, about your condition subsequently. And Liz, you're now what, you're a full-time carer?
Yes, absolutely.
Yeah, okay. And the chair that we see Jason in today, I mean, Jason, you must have a vehicle elsewhere then that this vehicle goes into that enables you both to get around. Is that right?
Yeah, we have a big van.
A big van, yeah.
Yeah, that goes for a lift.
Yeah.
Drive in and then lock it down.
Yeah. And is it, I mean, I've never had the opportunity to ask anybody before about this, but are you in a routine with that now? It's not a routine I'm sure you'd rather not have, but if you're going to have a routine of getting around, you know, is it a bit like Thunderbirds? I mean, the back comes down, you go, and is it a bit like that?
Yeah, absolutely. It's got a hydraulic ramp on the back, and we can, it has a remote control, so we can operate it from outside the van.
Yeah.
Jason can operate it, the ramp comes down, he drives in, the wheelchair clamps down to the floor of the van, and off we go.
And you got how many children?
Two.
It's got two children. And is the van converted so that you can all travel as a family?
Yeah, absolutely. And everywhere we go as well, we need a carer as well, because Jason now needs 24-hour care.
Right, yeah, yeah.
And, you know, he has extensive care needs. He needs everything doing for him. So we also have a carer from 7 till 7. So anywhere we go, we have to have room for Jason, the wheelchair, me, the carer, and the two children.
Wow, you see why you need a big van then.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Okay, hold on there. Don't go anywhere. I need to do traffic and travel news, and Greg is here, so let's get you bang up to date with the very, very latest. Greg Edwards, hello. Go on, do your thing.
Thanks, Phil. Will do. Out on the motorways this afternoon, everything is looking okay. No problems as well around Grimsby. Traffic is on the move, looking at the traffic sensors. Quick reminder that some roadworks are underway if you're out and about in the Humberston area, though. The B1219 Humberston Avenue, temporary traffic lights for a couple of weeks, just near to the A1031 junction. Traffic around Hull is all looking okay, really. Just the usual busy spots. Roadworks are underway still, though, in the Patrington area. The Marketplace has some work on the gas mains just for a couple of days near to the junction with St Patrick's Green, which might cause some short hold-ups there for a while. If you can update us, do call in if it's safe to do so on 0330 123 0182, and there's more in half an hour.
This is Phil White on BBC Radio Humberside.
Mike, hello, Mike in Hull. Thank you for yours, which I shall be passing on to the adjudicators. Thank you very much for your note or the text there. Weather-wise, we're saying about the Tan Hill pub, which is strictly speaking in North Yorkshire, or does it kind of go into East Yorkshire at that point? West Yorkshire at that point?
No, I think it's North Yorkshire. It's kind of on the border with Cumbria, I think.
Yeah, it's a long way up, isn't it? I don't know what their weather's like today, as you suggest. It's probably
snowy, I believe.
It's snowy. We've not had any snow here so far today, I don't think. Although it is going to be certainly cold this afternoon, with a chance of a shower, a rainy shower, that is, tea time and earlier on into the evening. Cold and 0 Celsius, 32 Fahrenheit. By even 7 o'clock, it's going to get really cold really quickly. And -2 by first thing tomorrow, -2, 28 Fahrenheit there. So an overcast start to Tuesday, 0 Celsius, 32 Fahrenheit by mid-morning at best. And then snow flurries and sunny spells from lunchtime onwards till about the middle of the afternoon tomorrow. 1 Celsius, 34 Fahrenheit. Best for daytime highs tomorrow. Let's play a tune, because Jason and Liz are here. Jason Liversidge and Liz Liversidge are here, selecting music and chatting as well about their lives together. I've got the first song up, Heaven, Bryan Adams. And actually, all your songs are a little bit on the rocky side. Is that, Jason, because you're a bit of a rocker?
No, kind of music, yeah.
Yeah. Guitar does it for you, Liz?
Yeah, I like a bit of rock.
Yeah? Why Bryan Adams and why Heaven, then?
Well, the reason we chose this song is because it was one of our wedding songs.
Was it?
Yes.
Oh, not you're not first dance song.
No. We didn't really do dancing. We did more of a bit of drinking.
Come on, you can't just say it was one of our wedding songs and leave it there. Is it? I mean, is it really special for the two of you, this song?
Yeah, I think we've seen band in concert twice.
Oh, right, OK.
You know, I seen him at home when it came 8 years ago.
Yeah.
I mean, it's a bit of a favourite, really.
All right, that's good enough for me. It's Brian Adams. See, I've heard people trying to do... If you ever thought Brian Adams wasn't a good singer, I've heard people trying to do that on the karaoke, and trust me, Brian Adams is a good singer, because I've never heard anybody be able to do that on the karaoke. 20-3, Mike says, I've just stepped out to start the school run to Sirius Academy, Westville, and there's a little flurry of snow beginning to fall, and Liz immediately observed the same behind me. Although, oh no, there was one. That was a big one that just went down there. Liz and Jason are with us this afternoon in the chair. Phil's folk, Jason Liversidge, Liz as well, husband and wife, married, what, 20, when did you get married? didn't ever ask you that. I asked you when you got
2010.
Met. 2010. So this will be 8 years of wedded bliss coming up this year. He's smiling. You have to agree with that. And the thing you can't appreciate, obviously, listener, and at home, unless I say it, is that Jason is in. Is this the robo chair? This one. You got a Terminator chair as well.
Absolutely.
And in a wheelchair, fully sort of motorised, because Jason, you've got motor neurone disease, which when you guys first met, you were telling us. You're fine, no problem at all as far as you were aware. What were the first signs there might have been something going on with your body that you weren't expecting?
My right thumb was starting to get weak.
Yeah.
And writing was hard. And then I've got a little tissue from there.
Okay.
But that was the first sign.
Okay. And Liz, I mean, crumbs, all people get ill from time to time, and you tend not to think anything about the sort of simple bits and pieces. So when were you as a family aware there was more to this than it just being a bit of a thing on his thumb that might pass?
I think the first time we were really aware of it was before we had the girls. We'd been married about 5 months, and Jason started to experience some really strange symptoms. He had some tingling and slurred speech, and which seemed to get worse over a few days. I looked out the window one morning and he was repeatedly crashing the car over and over again into the fence at the front of the house, which was a bit alarming.
What do you mean crashing the... What was that all about?
He was literally reversing the car and crashing over and over again into the fence.
Yeah.
So obviously I knew that there was something seriously
wrong.
So he was admitted to hospital where he spent about 12 days.
Yeah.
They never did come up with a diagnosis. But during that time, he became much worse. He wasn't able to, although he was able-bodied, he wasn't able to wash himself, shower himself, use his mobile phone, use a lift, use a knife and fork. So there was something going on neurologically, but they weren't sure what it was.
And Jason, the stuff that Liz is talking about there, do you remember that? I mean, do you remember the incident with the car and the... You remember it all really clearly?
Yeah.
And what were your emotions? Because, going from able-bodied man to being aware there might be something's going on here to stuff like that. I mean, was it sounds stupid to ask you, but was it scary?
It was weird about that. Good. Knew how to send a text message, but couldn't actually do it.
Yeah.
Couldn't operate a door or got a shower. God. Just physically could do it, but not mentally. And I wasn't actually sure what was going on.
What was going on? No, I can believe that. And clearly this afternoon, if you just switched on, are you thinking Jason's speech? That is Jason's real voice. Jason does have a computerised voice as well, but Jason is speaking with his own voice, and it's quite tiring for you. I can imagine it is quite tiring for you.
Yeah, it gets worse towards the end of the day.
When you've had a lot on, And does the weather make a difference? I mean, bearing in mind it's cold, reasonably cold. I know it's cold and bright, but does the weather make a difference?
Not really.
Okay, so you don't get any more tired any more quickly when it's cold, I suppose, is what I'm thinking.
No.
Motor neurone disease, for people that don't know, Liz, is, well, if you can describe it simply, because I'm a man of simple medical explanations, please.
Obviously, it's a neurological condition that affects the motor neurons or the nerves in the brain. Those would normally send the signals to muscles, which would make you move when you wanted to. With motor neurone disease, those signals become intermittent, a bit like a faulty cable, and then they stop working altogether.
Yeah.
So people become eventually unable to walk, unable to move, completely paralysed and trapped in a failing body, but the mind is usually unaffected. Most people with motor neurone disease have speech and communication difficulties, and as you can hear, Jason's voice has been affected.
Yeah, and it's not, sadly... Our knowledge of how to cope with this particular condition is such that there is no cure. I mean, it's inevitable that it's, I'm sorry, mate, but it's not it's not going to get any better.
No.
How are your girls with this? Because your girls are really, really young. I mean, do they know the full kind of prognosis?
Not really. No, the girls are very young. They're only 4 and 6.
Yeah.
But actually, when Jason received the diagnosis, Poppy was only 4 months old, and Lily was about 22 months. So obviously.
No point explaining anything at that age.
And as they've got older, obviously, they do know a little bit more. They know that Daddy's got motor neurone disease, and they know that the doctors can't make him better.
Yeah.
But, we haven't told them that he's terminally ill because, how can you explain that to a 4 and 6-year-old?
Yeah.
They just wouldn't understand. The prognosis is 2 to 5 years, but half of the people diagnosed die within 14 months of diagnosis. So it can be, you know, well, it is devastating to anybody and can be very rapidly progressive.
You, at some stage, Jason, you've had to come to terms with all this and you've had to decide, right, I'm guessing you've had to decide, I've got this much time left, I'm going to live with my kids, make sure that I have great memories with my kids. But also, you do give a lot of time over to charity and fundraising and research, and we'll talk about that in just a moment's time. But do you remember a moment at which that sort of switch happened for you? Because you could be forgiven for, you know, anybody in the same situation as you, you could be forgiven for just thinking, life just sucks, but you don't appear to be the kind of person that feels that. Was there a moment where life turned for you?
For about 2 or 3 weeks after the diagnosis, I got a big ball, and I'd sit there, and I'll get on with it. So, you know, get on with it, we do. You know, without doing day-to-day things, or, you know, go to mountain or go to holiday, we just get on and do it.
Just get on with it and do it.
Yeah.
Jason's never been the sort of person to think, why me, or be angry about it. You know, I've thought, why me?
Yeah.
But Jason's not that sort of person. He's a very laid-back sort of character. And, you know, although it took some accepting, he did accept it and he decided that he was just going to get on with it and live his life to the full, the best that he could.
I want to play your second choice of music and then we want to chat about what you're doing and some of the things you're up to right now. Let's play Bon Jovi. We Weren't Born to Follow is the tune. This is an important tune to you because...
I think it pretty well described the way we go about things. I never do that, so, you know, listen, we just get on and do it.
Here we go, here's the tune.
This one goes out to the man who minds for miracles. This one goes out to the ones in need. This one goes out to the sinner and the cynical. This ain't about no apology. This road was paved by the hopeless and the hungry. This road was paved by the winds of change. Walking beside the guilty and the innocent. How will you raise your hand when they call your name? Yeah, yeah, yeah. We weren't born.
Oh, you've got to like a bit of Bon Jovi, haven't you? We weren't born to follow is the song. At 10 to 3, Andy's here at 3. We're going to play some Tom Petty as well before we go. And we've got to get more chat out of Jason and Liz. And quickly, can we go back and just mention quickly about your daughters and is it called Fabry disease? Now, this was something we kind of whizzed over when we were talking about Jason's condition, motor neurone disease. Mm-hmm. But actually, Jason, you've not got one life limiting illness, you've got two.
No, I'm very greedy.
You are, aren't you?
We like to say special.
Special, yeah. And I can imagine that you were saying kind of in jest that, you know, the medics love you because there's a lot there to sort of dig around in and find out about. But I'd never even heard of Fabry's disease. So what's that? What is that?
Fabry disease is a really rare genetic condition that only affects one in 140,000 people. It basically is a storage disorder, so Jason lacks an enzyme called GALA, which would normally break down waste products,
yeah.
But because he doesn't have this enzyme, they build up in all the cells in the body, causing global organ damage. So people die of kidney failure, heart failure or stroke.
Yeah, but it's rare, but with something as specific as that, and they've even identified down to the gene, that it's almost unimaginable they can't treat it. But I suppose it's so rare that their resources go elsewhere, do they, Jason?
I'm on treatment for it, but obviously went 37 years unnoticed. So 37 years of damage.
Yeah,
it's pretty much impossible to rectify.
It doesn't stop you. I know it doesn't stop you. Any of this doesn't stop you as a couple, as a family, or anything. And you've got things, including a plan to abseil down. Where is this place you're going to abseil?
It's Gaping Gill Potter, which is on the side of Mount Ingleborough in the Yorkshire Dales.
Right. And so, how's this going to work then? What's the plan?
Well, as you know, we've already done a few things.
You have?
To raise
well,
money.
Go on, like for what, for instance?
Well, for example, Jason's done the longest zip wire in Europe and the fastest in the world. Last year, Jason became the first person to summit Mount Snowdon in a wheelchair, raising £7,700 for Marie Curie and our local Dove House Hospice.
Didn't I see an F1 mentioned somewhere in the notes as well? And you've done a bit of F1
yeah,
racing?
Yeah, he's done a bit of Formula One driving around Silverstone and Donington.
Gee.
And then after Snowdon in September last year, Jason abseiled off the Humber Bridge, raising money for the Firefighters Charity and the Motor Neurone Disease Association.
Goodness.
Almost £10,000.
Wow. And you're going to, what's this about the Hornsea Marathon? Is it a marathon or half marathon you're starting?
I think it's the Hornsea Third Marathon.
The Third Marathon.
I don't know whether you know this, but Jason's been involved with, well, we've already mentioned Marie Curie.
Yeah.
Part of the money from Snowdon went towards Marie Curie.
Yeah.
Well, Jason's also been helping Marie Curie with a great daffodil appeal. And as part of that, he's been asked to open the Hornsea Third Marathon in April because the Rotary Club run the marathon, but they run the marathon to raise money for Marie Curie.
Fantastic. That'll be a treat. That would be a nice, if the sun's shining like this today, that'll be a lovely day out. So you've got, basically, you have a full diary and a really, really active life. Is that fair?
Yeah.
Yeah. And long may it continue, certainly. And much love to your daughters. If you were raising money this year, is there one charity, if people would like to support the work that you're doing, is there one charity, is there one web page they can go to?
We don't have a specific web page because we like to support different charities, but we were recently involved with the Masonic Charitable Foundation. Jason's father and stepfather and grandfather were all Masons, and they recently made a mini video series about our adventures at the Bendrigg Trust in Cumbria.
Oh, yeah.
So that video series was released a few weeks ago, and the last part of that documentary is going to be released tomorrow. So we became friends with the people at Bendrigg in Cumbria, and this year we'd like to raise money for another family to be able to go to the Bendrigg Trust in Cumbria, who cater for people with severe disabilities.
You know, what can I say? It's an absolute pleasure. It really is genuinely an absolute pleasure to meet you both. And thank you for coming in. And particularly, Jason, it's been a huge effort for you this afternoon. I'd love to have heard your arty, your computer voice. I'd love to have heard that. We'll have to do that sometime. But thank you very much. Before you go, we've got one more tune to play. It's Tom Petty and Learning to Fly. Which of you, Jason, Liz, would like to tell me about, or could both tell me why we're playing this one?
Well, the reason we chose this song is because when we went to the Bendrigg Trust in Cumbria, this song was played and it reminds us of the great time we had there.
Let's play that. Andy Comfort's on the radio pretty soon. Liz, Jason, thanks for coming in. Good to see you.
Thank you.
Well, I started out down a dirty road. Started out all alone. And the sun went down as I crossed the hill. And the town lit up. The world got still. I'm learning to fly, but I ain't got wings. Coming down is the hardest thing. Well, the good old days may not return. Rocks might melt and the seed may burn. I'm learning to fly, but I ain't got wings. Coming down is the hardest thing. You down and break your heart, steal your crown. So I started out for God knows where. I guess I'll know when I get there. I'm learning to fly around the clouds, but what goes up must come down. Hardest thing. I'm learning to fly around the clouds, but what goes up must come down.